Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text this morning is taken from the Holy Gospel, where Jesus tells us that we are to be preparing for God's judgment. Please be seated. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, the last three Sundays of the church year focus on the last times, the judgment of the world, and our Lord Jesus Christ's return. God's judgment, the last day, or judgment day, is a teaching of the church that many Christians today don't even consider. Some Christians don't even believe that there will be a judgment day, contrary to what God teaches in His holy word. Those preconceived notions of man are very, very dangerous teachings. My brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, we must understand exactly what Jesus is teaching in the gospel today. Jesus is teaching of the end of the Jewish temple in Jerusalem, the end of Israel, essentially, as the chosen people, the end of the world, the Jewish world, as the Jews would know it. He's teaching, yes, about judgment. So when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let the one who is on the housetop not go down to take out of what is in his house. And let the one who is in the field not turn back for his cloak. And alas for women who are pregnant and for those who are nursing infants in those days. Pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath. Many just don't believe that the end of the world is upon us and that we are living in the end times. But as Christians, we have been living in the end times ever since Jesus' death, His resurrection, His ascending, and the pouring out of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. On the day of Pentecost, St. Peter preached to the world from the prophet Joel, "In the last days I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh." This is exactly what happened on the day of Pentecost. And the prophecy says that this will happen in those last days. My friends, this prophecy from Joel has nothing whatsoever to do with blood moons or with a secret rapture or with any other hocus pocus that is being taught in some churches today. Of course we are living in the end times, and Christians should always be living with the expectation that Jesus is going to return at any time. This, however, is never a reason for us to panic. Rather, we should be rejoicing, as you heard with the children. We should be rejoicing because our Lord will keep His promise. He kept His promise to forgive us of all our sins here. He kept His promise that He would rise on the third day. He kept His promise by saying that He will go into heaven and there prepare a place for us so that He can come back and take us to where He is. Jesus will keep His promise. So this brings us then to the question of the Jewish temple, which, by the way, as you recall, was made with stones and other earthly material. Jesus prophesied this morning that a great abomination would be set up in the sanctuary. Then the temple would be destroyed. Approximately 40 years passed, and the abomination of sacrifice, the priests standing in the temple and making sacrifices, continued in the temple. In the year 67, the Roman army surrounded Jerusalem, and in the year 70 AD, the temple was destroyed, just as Jesus prophesied. Remember what the disciples told Jesus there in the last times before He went to the cross? Look at all these grand buildings, Jesus, and his response. You see all these, don't you? Truly I say to you, there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down. Jesus kept his prophecy. Jesus was true. The Romans completely destroyed the temple. And it's still destroyed this day. It's not there. You could go to the Temple Mount. You see the Western Wall, and that's all you see. In the Gospel of John, Jesus speaks of himself as the temple of God. For us, in Jesus, is where we meet. It's in Jesus is where we have fellowship. It's where we commune together. Jesus says, abide in me and I in you. When we come together, dear friends, we don't come together in a building, although we worship here in a building, but we're actually coming together in Jesus Christ himself. All through the letters of St. Paul, Paul says that the baptized are in Christ, that we are baptized into Christ. Peter says even that we are built as spiritual stones into a spiritual house with Jesus Christ as the cornerstone. So you see, our temple is Jesus himself, and we are also his temple, for the Holy Spirit resides in you and in me. Every worship service here at Zion begins and must always begin with words reminding you of your baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You just heard that. We gather within Christ, our temple, where the Father promises to dwell and where we receive the Holy Spirit. You see, the grand, beautiful temple in Jerusalem was destroyed, and it will never, ever be rebuilt. Since Jesus is the temple, it's in Jesus we worship. He is the new Israel. You and I have no need of a building or the rebuilding of a building so that Jesus can return. For your temple is here, dear friends. Here is where Jesus lives. He serves, he forgives, he saves, and he will return, just as he promised. Because of the unbelief of the chief priests and the teachers of the law, the Jews, as John would call them, the abomination of desolation is spoken of by Daniel, there will be great tribulation, such as has not been from the beginning of the world until now, and no will ever be. The leaders of Israel thought that their good intentions, their heritage, their good works would save them. And it's the same today in many churches across America and this world. They think, they teach, that it doesn't matter what you believe, as long as you're sincere in your belief. Good intentions, dear friend, your sincerity will not save you. Only Christ's good intentions, only his work, only his death, only his resurrection has saved you. Jesus prophesied that the church is always going to be a suffering church. I think you and I, we know this, that we suffer each and every day. Jesus never promised that the true church would be a mega church, by the way. Large numbers of people in any given building does not mean that Jesus has blessed them. Jesus says, where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am among them. The Holy Spirit tells us that on that great day of Pentecost, that the true church are those who devote themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. You see, my friends, other churches are waiting for the latest expert to write the latest book so that they can mess around and attempt to implement their latest harebrained scheme. not to mention false prophet after false prophet after false prophet, who claims to speak for God, performing miracles and so-called faith healings, calling it upon everyone to believe in them as God. They are the newest and latest Messiah, with a small M, by the way. And by the way, they want you to reach into your pocket and give to them all your money so that you'll be blessed. Even in Jesus' name, false teachings are proclaimed, human efforts, human works, the latest thrills and novelties, abominations, which will cause desolation. Jesus tells us what's going to happen. Jesus tells us that the days will be cut short, as it was for the Jews. You see, God sent the prophet Ezekiel, and he told Ezekiel to go ahead of him and go to the people and preach the good news. And God said to Ezekiel, "The house of Israel will not be willing to listen to you, for they are not willing to listen to me, because all the house of Israel have hard foreheads and a stubborn heart." Just like many Christians today have hard foreheads and a stubborn heart. They think their works will save them. They think their latest fad is the thing and the way to go. They completely forget about this book. By the way, when preachers preach, they preach a single verse, and it's almost always 100% out of context. You see, my friends, what Jesus teaches us today, it will stand. It is the truth. People don't take notice of Jesus' words of judgment, but his words in our Gospels are words of judgment, and it should be read and understood today. There will be people who today who will call themselves Christians, who are always being drawn away from the cross of Christ. They're always being drawn away to the glitz and glamour of modern evangelicalism. They want to be entertained by the latest fad. But the times of the church really are times of great tribulation. And there will always be false prophets who will perform many wonders and miracles and draw large crowds and smile and tell them that you can do it on your own, for every day's a Friday. Don't believe it, Jesus says. Don't believe it. Wherever the corpse is, there the vultures will gather. I remember one of my first times here staying in the parsonage, and I looked out over the pasture, and there were the vultures, and they were gathering. I thought there was a dead calf, but it was something else. But it reminded me, as I looked at this text, of what vultures do, of what turkey buzzards do. They go after the rotting flesh. Vultures gather, my dear friends, to devour putrid, rotting flesh. Just as some are gathered around certain people to devour their putrid and rotting teachings. Every Sunday when you come to Zion, my dear friends, you present yourself to God, and you are in and actually being in His living presence. And as we teach the truth of His Word, there is no rotting, putrid teaching here. It is the Word of God, and it is the truth. As Jesus says, "Lord, Your Word is truth. Sanctify them. Set them apart. Teach them by the truth." So, my dear friends, even when you come to the Lord's Supper, which frankly we should be celebrating each and every Sunday, when we come to receive His body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins, you are in the presence of your Lord, and you are receiving from Him the truth. You're receiving from Him the forgiveness of all your sins. Jesus comes not to condemn, but He comes so that you might be saved through Him. When Jesus comes, and it'll be no secret, we will see Him. Every eye will see Him. When we come And when he comes for us, we will certainly rejoice. Therefore, my friends, this is what Christ does for us each and every week. He is here in our presence to forgive you of all your sins. He is here to serve you his word. He is here to serve you his body and blood, so that your faith will be strengthened, so that you can face the trials and tribulations of this life. But stand fast. Stand always fast, knowing that your Lord is with you, and his promise is that he will never, ever forsake you. And on that great last day, which will happen, you and I will stand to his right, as you will hear about next week. But those who devour the putrid teachings of false teaching will be to the left. My dear friends, Jesus Christ is your Savior. He is the same yesterday and today and always. Your Lord, your Messiah, your King, your Redeemer. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.